Thank you all for being here. My name is Lori Quinn. I am on faculty in the Biobehavioral Sciences Department, and I'm the director of the Neurorehabilitation Research Lab. The aim of our lab is to evaluate physical activity and exercise interventions in people with neurodegenerative diseases, one of those diseases being Parkinson's disease. I'm very happy to have David and Greg here with us today, and we just want to share with you some of the work that we've been doing in collaboration with David and also with some researchers at Washington University on a dance, sort of a new dance program for people with Parkinson's disease. When David first approached me and Pietro Massoni, who is a neurologist at Columbia who's moved to Washington University, about the opportunity to work on a new dance program in Parkinson's disease, I really jumped at the chance because it worked so well with the mission of our program in biobehavioral sciences in trying to understand how exercise, rehabilitation, and physical activity can improve the health and well-being of people with neurodegenerative diseases. And over the past years we've worked together, I've really come to believe so strongly that dance is one of the premier interventions that we can do with people with neurodegenerative diseases, and I think it can have a really powerful impact, not just on their lives and their well-being, but on the progression of the disease. So I'm really excited to share some of that with you today. I'm going to provide a very brief overview of sort of where we got to, how we've gotten to this point. And David's going to take the bulk of the talk to sort of talk about dance and the Dance for PD program and some of our new ideas. And then Greg is going to present a bit about the pilot study and our efforts to evaluate the efficacy of this new program. So just a really quick bit about Parkinson's disease and why exercise and physical activity might be really important. There's a range of what we call motor and non-motor symptoms that happen with people with Parkinson's disease. So as the disease comes on with people, you might see gait or walking impairments. You may see postural instabilities, and that puts people at risk for having falls and decreased mobility. But there's, and that's kind of the face of Parkinson's disease oftentimes, but there's a lot of non-motor symptoms that go along with the disease, things like depression and apathy, there's cognitive decline, things like constipation and sleep problems can really have a tremendous impact on individuals' quality of lives. And then there's secondary comorbidity, because a lot of what happens if you have some of these non-motor symptoms like depression, alongside some of these motor symptoms like difficulty walking, that increases your chances for having a more sedentary lifestyle. And then that feeds into a lot of the secondary comorbidities that we see, things like osteoporosis and cardiovascular disease, which have nothing to do with Parkinson's disease, but happen as a secondary effect of lack of mobility and sedentary lifestyle. So exercise can have a positive effect on all of these aspects. From the motor, specifically from the motor symptoms, exercise is known to increase just feelings of well-being and decrease feelings of apathy, so it tends to improve depression. Exercise, specifically aerobic exercise, has been shown to improve cognitive abilities in individuals. And so all of these things can be affected by exercise and physical activity. Importantly, exercise also drives neuroplasticity. It has an effect on the brain. And how does it do this? By it increases synaptic strength. So there's certain neurotransmitters that are very prominent within the brain, and it can increase the strength of those synaptic connections. And it can also improve overall brain health. So just by increasing blood flow overall throughout the central nervous system, you can have an increase in development of new neural connections. So that's really exciting, because that can result in some secondary improvements in strengthening circuitry that might be impaired with Parkinson's disease, and thus resulting in improved motor, cognitive, mood, and motivation. But the problem is, exercise is not a pill. It's not always easy to get people to exercise or to encourage people to exercise. And I'm sure all of us sitting in this room have had experiences of, oh, I don't feel like exercising today. And it's just not easy sometimes to get ourselves motivated to do it. So it's not as if, you know, exercise is a pill and we can just give it to everyone and they'll take it and everyone will get better. It's really hard. And this was just a famous quote by the director of the National Institutes of Aging at NIH, who said if exercise could be packaged into a pill, it would be the single most widely prescribed and beneficial medicine in the nation, because there are so many things, from decreasing your risk for cancer and cardiovascular diseases, and now all that we know about the neuroplasticity effects of exercise, that it would be a very powerful pill if we could package it that way. And so how can we better package exercise? Well, one of the things is to not say the word exercise. Mm-hmm. And so we're trying to think about ways, especially in our lab, that we can get people to move and not have it have a negative connotation to it. And so again, when David approached us about this project, I thought, I know a lot about the Dance for PD program, but it really is the perfect intervention, because it has some of the key aspects that we know are really critical to improving movement and improving permanent learning and producing this neuroplasticity. It focuses on goal-based learning. There's a cognitive aspect to learning a dance, watching someone do something and trying to match their movements. The whole concept of experience-dependent neuroplasticity, the environment that's created, the music, has a really powerful effect on the brain and our movements. The aerobic training that you can get from dance, as I was talking about earlier, can really have a beneficial effect on cognition and other aspects, and the enhanced cognitive engagement through exercise that we can see in patients. So what we've tried to do is match physical therapy, rehabilitation, with dance, and trying to make it fun. So we've developed, over the past year, an intervention that kind of marries these two. So we have a dance routine. I'm going to let David talk a lot more about this. We specifically think about what the dance teacher or instructor is going to be doing. We're thinking about what the social interaction is and what the environment is. So we've laid out, and I won't go through them specifically, but activities that we know are problematic in people with Parkinson's disease. So things like difficulty with trunk rotation, difficulty with modulating speed of movement, and we've incorporated these, or I could say, I asked David to incorporate these into a dance routine, which he has developed. And so it's a choreographed routine, and we'll have relatively small class sizes. And one of the things we really thought about was whether it was going to be partnered or not, because there's a lot of work that's been done in partnered dance programs. But we decided for this particular one that we didn't want to have it be partnered, that it was a lot more about the artistic expression of dance. And then we thought a lot about the location and the flooring and the music, because all of these are very complex aspects of this intervention and can have a really powerful impact on the intervention. So I'm going to let David take over now, and he'll talk a little bit more.
Hi, everybody. I'm going to give you just a little bit of background about the Dance for PD program, so you understand, if those of you who don't know a lot about dance and dance training, can understand why this kind of approach might be so helpful for this particular population. So the Dance for PD program started really on a hunch by this woman here named Ole Westheimer. And Ole was the support group leader of the Brooklyn Parkinson Group. And she had this idea that in many ways, medical interventions didn't address many of the quality of life issues and many of the motor issues that people with Parkinson's had difficulty with. And she really wanted to think about an intervention, a program that would allow people to step away from Parkinson's for part of their week, not be consumed by the sort of medicalized identity. And she thought a lot about dance because it was social and fun. People were able to come together and connect. But she also thought about the strategies that dancers use to learn, execute, and perform new movement. And of course, with Parkinson's, many of the movements that we take for granted have to be relearned and reapproached because they are no longer automatic. So to give you a very quick example, this is a German physician and physicist named von Helmholtz. And von Helmholtz worked a lot with optical perception, so how the brain sees the world around us, and had talked a lot about this idea of looking at different points in space and how the brain actually edits out all the information in between because it overwhelms the inputs. You know, if you try to scan and take in all of that information, we get very tired very easily. And she thought about this translation into dance because it's exactly what dancers do in their training to turn. If you think about an ice skater turning, right? An ice skater goes like this. I don't know how they don't get dizzy, honestly. When a dancer turns, a dancer looks at one spot and pops his or her head around to that same spot. So when I finish turning, do my eight pirouettes, I'm not dizzy, right? So that's a neurological strategy, really, to maintain focus and balance in the course of a difficult movement. So Ole thought a lot about this and said, you know what? Dancers are actually movement experts whose training allows them to absorb very difficult movement concepts and make them seem natural again. I wonder if that would be helpful for people with Parkinson's. So we look a little bit deeper into what dance can do. We're gonna look at six different elements. So one is that, like all athletic pursuits, it does develop strength, flexibility, and stamina. And I'm gonna add balance to this because there's a lot of research on different kinds of physical activity and balance in Parkinson's. And of course, dance, whether you're doing tango or hula or ballet, is very much focused on dynamic balance. Being able to maintain your posture and support in the middle of lots of different kinds of action, right? So in addition to those more athletic goals, we're also looking at a very sophisticated motor learning construct. When we look at, this is George Balanchine here, training a very early version of New York City Ballet. Dancers take class every single day of their careers. So yes, it's true that musicians practice by themselves and also in ensembles. Dancers actually go to class where somebody tells them and trains them in what to do every single day. And so this idea of mastering skills through repetition is part of dance training and a very important element of any kind of rehabilitation for people with Parkinson's who have difficulty absorbing and remembering new movement material. I think of Parkinson's often as a sort of anti-theatrical condition because it affects lots of modes of human expression. Amplitude, facial expression, voice, projection, and enunciation. Dance, of course, is all about expressing meaning through gesture. So to have people with Parkinson's come into a dance environment and actually get to express meaning and emotion through their bodies is a very significant transformation. Music is the underpinning of almost all dance forms around the world, not everyone, but almost all, and forms a basis for our program as well. All the programs here in New York use live music, and we know that's an essential factor, not just in executing movement, but in learning and remembering movement. A lot of the music in our program are things that people know. They're songs that people can sing along to, and that actually helps underpin the learning experience. Aesthetic, not just functional goals. So when we think about a dance movement, it's not just the how, the mechanics of it, but it's the what. What image are we trying to create? What idea are we trying to get across? So movements have meaning, and they have a particular aesthetic that we're going for. Even if somebody is just moving a tiny bit, they can still think about the quality of that movement, and that actually gives them access to a way of thinking about it that is quite helpful. This seems obvious, but it's a very important goal, and it goes back to Ole's original vision, which was that dancers very rarely work by themselves. They're always working with somebody else, their partner, they're working in a group. When we go back tens of thousands of years, we probably understand dance as some kind of integrated social communication tool, right, for reinscribing rules and ritual. So the value of connecting, the value of being part of a community, the value of belonging. These are all important in dance and very important for people living with Parkinson's. And finally, the cognitive elements. So in dancing, we have to be able to mirror other people. We have to be able to sequence movements, put one movement in front of the other. And these are complicated movements. We're not just talking about the left, right, and the arm swing of a treadmill or a bicycle, but actually movement one into movement two into movement three into movement four into movement five. And we then have to remember those movements and recall them. So it's a very complicated and sophisticated sequencing that has to happen. Which is why when we started the program, Ole really wanted it to be taught by professional dancers and dance instructors rather than people who are necessarily trained in Parkinson's therapy. She really wanted the knowledge that dancers had to be part of the equation. And when we go back and look at the things that a standard exercise intervention addresses, that Lori talked about a bit, not only is it sort of difficult to have people swallow sometimes, but it really captures just a fraction of what people with Parkinson's have challenges with. So when we actually look at what exercise addresses and compare it to a dance activity or intervention, we start getting into not just the motor elements that Lori mentioned, but the non-motor elements, right? So social interaction, memory, confidence, creativity, relationship with partners, self-esteem, and self-efficacy. And these are critical factors in maintaining quality of life for folks with Parkinson's. But above this, when people come into this class, they are learning an art form. They're not trying to solve a problem. And I think that's a very different way of thinking about an activity or intervention. And that frames their entire experience in that activity. So as a dance organization, we're very non-denominational in the kind of research we do. We're interested in all of the above. So we've done quality of life surveys, personal narrative, attendance records to try to look at attrition and adherence. We've looked at organizational effects, how the program actually affects the dance companies in which it is run. But we're right at the moment focused on one particular element of our class, which is walking. And I'm going to talk a little bit about walking and then pass it on to Greg, who will go much deeper than I. So I wanted to show you a little bit of video here to kind of make the case. And again, as with a lot of the research that we've been involved with, it all comes from observation and participant accounts. So this is a little clip from a film about a program that we helped start in London at the English National Ballet. Get this going here. Okay.
There have been measurable changes in balance and stability. It's very noticeable, actually, in quite a few people. For example, John, when he was walking across the floor right at the end of class to get his stick, and he was walking quite jauntily, quite normally, without stuttering or stumbling at all, which he sometimes does.
I can now walk and I can sing quietly, inwardly. Nelly the elephant packed the trunk to send the circus, trumpety trump. And you walk to that and you can find it easier to walk. So if I'm in a difficult situation, that's what I do.
See, Jane's walking off in rhythm, so she's still got the time and that tempo from the dancing in her head to actually help her move out. It's great to see that.
I've taken charge of my own life now. I'm aware that I'm limited and restricted in what I do, but I want to improve the quality of my life the best way I can.
So we took some of these observations and we thought, well, we see people for 75 minutes once or twice a week. What are they doing the rest of the time? How are they managing and navigating the world? So we had an opportunity to apply for a grant from Google to create a platform that would allow us to test some of these ideas around walking and movement motivation, movement cueing. And we created an app called Moving Through Glass, which is a portable, private, wearable app that has video and music. So if somebody has difficulty initiating movement, they can say, okay, Glass, walk with me. And they'll actually see an image of a dancer walking in their little screen. And they can entrain, which means to follow rhythmically, entrain to that movement. So I'm going to show you just a brief example of walk with me. So this is what you would see in your right hand, your right eye screen. And you'd be able to follow that as you listen to the music. And nobody has to know what you're watching. You could be watching Days of Our Lives, right? But actually you're watching a very helpful, or we think helpful, cueing system really designed for you. All right. So when we started having discussions with Lori and Pietro, we talked about all of this and we said, well, we've been doing these kind of pilots with Moving Through Glass and we use a lot of dance walking in our class. And what we actually realized is that we wanted the study to look at the act of walking as a dance and actually to create a dance around the act of walking. So I wanted to show you just two examples of this from actual choreography. to really to back up this idea that walking is dancing and that choreographers use walking all the time in their dancing. But there's a specific approach that dancers use when they walk, and that's really what we're trying to get at this. It's a sense of deep commitment, of sense of flow, and of pleasure. So the first excerpt is from a piece called Going Away Party by Mark Morris. It's the music by Bob Wills, who's a Texas two-step band. So everybody's just walking. There's, you know, it's walking patterns, but very rhythmic walking and stylized walking, very relaxed, with some changes of direction in there as well. So the question is, when does the walking and the dancing begin? My argument is that they're already dancing. I'm going to show you one more example from another choreographer, Jerome Robbins. And this is a piece called Glass Pieces. Some of you may have seen it, New York City Ballet. And you'll see, again, a very dancerly version of walking, but it's really just walking.
Glass Pieces is an incredible ballet.
Everyone I know who's ever come to see this ballet raves about it.
Loves it.
Choreographed by Jerome Robbins. Kind of the scene opens onto like all these bodies in space crossing and weaving crossing, around each other. And then in this melee, these like alien couples sort of enter.
Most people who don't know much about ballet at least have heard the name Philip Glass.
The thing I think that's so instantly recognizable about Philip Glass is the repetition. It's driven by this unyielding pulse.
It's hard.
It's grueling. It is one of the most highly athletic ballets.
It really is.
I think in our rep.
So finally, after all our discussions, we thought, well, let's try to create our own walking dance that would incorporate all of these ideas that Lori and Greg and Pietro had sort of assigned me. So we want different speeds, we want changes of direction, we want trunk rotation, we might want to think about walking backwards. So I'm just going to show you a brief clip of what we have, and then I'll turn it over to Greg. See how many different movement elements you can spot in this. The idea is really to try to fit a lot of these sort of standard interventions into a dance that was recognizable as a dance, and most importantly, pleasurable as a dance. I'm going to turn it over to Greg.
Thank you. So I'll be talking more about the pilot study that we're doing and how we're actually designing the study that we're looking at now to look at the intervention. So this just shows the Medical Research Council framework for looking at complex interventions, because like Dr. Quinn said, that dance isn't a pill that we can take. So we don't just know whether it works or not, and kind of like, what are all the things that are going into it? Like, is it the social interaction? Is it the teacher's presence? Is it what even the teacher is saying to the people that's having the effect? So we can't just get to the implementation, or we don't just know whether it works right away, right? We have to kind of plan and account for all of the things that we're doing to get the best intervention possible. So we're trying to establish the feasibility and the acceptability of our intervention while we're still in the process of developing it. So we've designed this pilot study right now to go into the larger scale study. And this pilot study is really using 4 people with Parkinson's disease. We're looking at people with the Hoehn-Yahr scale of 1 and 2, which means that they're less impaired. So we're taking people that don't have freezing of gait and that are less impaired, because these are people that can safely get through a dance intervention right now. And then if we can, we'll move forward with more impairments. Right now we're looking at it for twice a week for 4 weeks, but I think the last one is 12 weeks, right? The full study is looking at 12 weeks right now. So the main things that we're trying to get out of our pilot study are our acceptability, our adherence, and our safety measures. So we want to know whether the people that are doing the intervention actually enjoy the intervention, and if they're actually coming to the intervention, and then again, whether it's safe for them to perform the entire task. So we're really designing this to look at, like David said, gait. Our main outcome measure that we're looking at is gait speed. We're trying to improve the speed at which they're walking at. So like Dr. Quinn said, we have the logic model here with the activities that David has put into the dance. So now we're here on this left-hand column of the implementation, evaluation, and kind of like the outputs. So in the first box, I'll talk about this a little bit more in a second, but we're doing video analysis on the dance because, again, it's complex and we have so much that we can look at, that video kind of gives us an opportunity to go back and also to be able to do like a frame by frame analysis. So the outputs that we're looking at are different outcomes. So we have the process outcomes, the behavioral, the immediate, and kind of the longer term outcomes that we're looking at. The process outcomes are really more of those acceptability measures, right? We're looking at the satisfaction of the individuals that are taking it, and we're also going to interview both the instructors and the participants to get these satisfaction outcome measures. Our behavioral outcome measures are more of our quantitative measures. So I'll show you on the next slide, but we're taking just like our basic gait parameter measures that we're looking at. And then the immediate outcome measures are more of those disease-specific measures that we can measure right after the intervention, and then with longer scale or longer term studies, we can look at whether they stay involved in dance after this one study, and also kind of what this has on long-term health. So this gives us just a breakdown of all of the outcome measures that we're currently looking at, because a second part of the pilot study is to actually find reliable outcome measures that we can use for the longer term study. So this shows the impairment, the activities, and the participation level. This is kind of a fluid model where some of these outcome measures don't quite fit into one, but this just gives us a nice visual representation of it. So the first one under the impairment column is the gait parameters. So on the left over here, you see that there's a person with Parkinson's disease, and in our lab, we have wearable sensor models, or wearable sensors that are inertial sensors. So we can quantify all the different gait parameters. So we're specifically looking at gait velocity to see whether that improves, but we're also looking at step length, stride length, and cadence throughout the intervention. The second thing that we were interested in was balance, because as David said, that dance is dynamic balance, even walking is controlled falling or a sense of dynamic balance. So we really wanted to include a measure that looked at balance. So this has been shown in all of the other dance studies to have some improvement, so we wanted to include this one. The next one is the UPDRS, which is the Unified Parkinson's Disease Rating Scale, which just gives us an idea of the impairment level of that individual. And we're using the third subset of that, which is really the motor score, so we can really quantify those motor outcome measures and that motor level of impairment in the people with Parkinson's disease. So going back to like the actual dance now, dance is something that you don't learn all at once, right? Like you learn 30 seconds of the dance, maybe a minute of the dance, and then as you go on, you start to learn more and more. So one of the things that we, after like lots of discussion, wanted to look at was the 6-minute walk test, because it's a measure of endurance. So the goal is, can they actually walk for 6 minutes? Where week one, they'll probably learn like 30 seconds of the dance, but we're probably going to include more sections of it. So they'll be learning and doing more and more physical activity and more part of the dance. So we really wanted to have some sort of way to measure endurance as well. This next one is the activity-specific balance confidence scale. This is more of a self-efficacy scale. So it's self-reported by the participant. We ask them different questions, but it's all based on how confident are you that you can perform X activity. Like one of the questions is, how confident are you that you can walk around your house without losing balance? And it's from 0 to 100%. Counting by 10, so 10, 20, 30, 40. So we wanted to see if they felt that they had gained balance after the intervention, right? It just gives us another way of looking at them, but it also gets that like self-efficacy aspect of the intervention as well. So the last level here is the participation, which these are more of the patient-reported outcomes measures. There's so many of these that you can like choose from, but we really wanted to look at their health, their physical function, and their sleep as just to give us an idea of kind of what's happening and to give us a way to like look at all of that. So the last thing, or the job that they entailed to me, was how do you prove fidelity in dance interventions? Because a lot of the dance studies, we said like you can use hula, you can use modern, but at the end of the day, when that goes into like a journal article, it says they did modern dance or they did contact improv dance. And what does that exactly mean? So we, for this dance specifically, or for this study, it's different from the dance for Parkinson's classes because we're actually creating a dance with these key elements where we're hoping that it has an improvement on gait or that it improves the way that they're walking. So we wanted to, one, make sure that those key elements are actually in the dance, which David has done very well, but also give a way that we could kind of quantify those aspects so that it can lead to more reproducible dance research. Because when you just say in a dance study, oh, I did tango, or oh, I did modern, does that mean that they were walking backwards, that they were walking forward? What kind of music were they using? Again, all of these like complex things get a little bit more muddy. So one of the things that we want to do is actually like use Data View, which this is a software that's open source. Anybody can download it. And it has been created by Karen Adolf, who is at NYU, and she's a motor development researcher. But we're trying to really use this to develop a protocol or a procedure that we can give to other people to quantify dance research, because there's a real need for that, because we don't really have a lot of reproducible research in general, but a lot in specifically in dance. So the other thing that we were trying to get at with this video analysis is those qualitative changes that dance has, because the APDM sensors are only going to give us, did their gait speed improve or did their step length improve? But both in like PT and in dance, one of those questions are, well, I can see them and it looks like they're doing it better, but how do we kind of like get at that, right? So we're trying to develop a protocol where we can, one, write down qualitative notes and develop some sort of assessment that we can use the videos for to really look at the changes over time. This probably won't happen as much in like the 1 week pilot study. Like we won't really see like a week from like one class to the next. But when you see that pretest of how they're doing that beginning section of the dance to how they do it at the end, there's a lot that's changed because of those like motor images or those cues or that like sense of flow or like embodiment that those dancers are taking on. Because that's one of the reasons why we go to see dancers dance, is because they really kind of take ownership of that movement. And we're really asking the PD patients to really take ownership of walking with this study.
Yeah. I don't know about that particular study, but music, I mean, there's been several studies about the effect of music on movement. And specifically, there's been a lot of work in Parkinson's disease done on this. And we, I think, know anecdotally that it can be extremely helpful. So you saw from the video that David had shown, I think how powerful music felt. Like the patient, the people who, after they were dancing, they were still sort of listening to the music. And this concept of entraining their movements with music. So one of the strategies I use as a physical therapist is having patients listen to music, or we use cueing. There's even using a metronome to cue patients to help them have a cue to be able to initiate movement. So it's really powerful, and it's something I think we've thought a lot about with the dance program.
I think that's a great question. I think our hope is that there actually is an internal kind of neurological or motor control change that happens as a result of the 12 weeks. That after those 12 weeks, people, their internal clock and pacing, gait pacing, is different. That's our first hope. The second, if that hasn't changed internally, can they actually set it to be higher by recalling the dance or listening to that music? So, and Pietro, our colleague, has talked a lot about this. He's like, it would be incredible if we could actually show that there was an internal change that happened automatically. That's something that current pharmacological or surgical interventions cannot do. So that would be significant. But it would also be significant if we gave people a toolkit to recall the experience of being in that dance to help them walk. That would also be a great outcome. So I think one of those is what we're hoping.
I think that's exactly, and I do want to emphasize that point of, we do want this to be a permanent change. That would be ideal, because we do have a lot of tools, and I think this could be an incredibly powerful tool. But the idea that we could use dance as an intervention that could sort of reset the clock, and this is something that Pietro feels really strongly about, that we don't have that right now, and that if we could have this intervention that could do that, it would be extremely powerful. Yeah. Any other questions?
So before I came to TC, I was a professional dancer, and I danced with Heidi Latsky Dance, which is a different dance company from the Mark Morris company, but we actually did a piece with blind dancers, and we used the wall for them so that they had that tactile sense. And then there were also little pieces of felt on the stage so that they can walk to a certain manner and like feel that felt piece before getting back to the wall. But we actually used the wall to create an environment in which they could perform tasks successfully.
I just want to say on that point, one of the things that Pietro Massoni, who, you know, really there's so many of the ideas here are his that he has talked about, is the joy of movement. He talks about that a lot. And I think that sort of speaks exactly to what you're saying, is that people who have, I think, a lot of neurological diseases or other kinds of physical problems have lost this joy of movement, or don't get to experience just the joy of moving. And so that's one of the things that's really important with this this work. 100%. I mean, I think it's maybe manpower right now and getting the ideas down. It's taken a year of us working to try to get to this point where we are now. And I think now that we have these core ideas developed, I think we'll start in Parkinson's disease. I work a lot with people with Huntington's disease. A lot of the students in my lab work with people who have had stroke. So I think you're right. It absolutely could. And the principles would really, I think, largely remain the same. There's some differences neurophysiologically that we might want to account for, but 100%.
So for more information about this specific kind of program, we invite people to visit the Dance for PD website, which is just danceforpd.org. There are classes right now in 17 countries that are based on this model that started in Brooklyn 15 years ago and 43 states. So we often get inquiries from people. It seems like one of those conditions where I start talking about the program and so I always get, oh, my brother, sister, mother, uncle, daughter has Parkinson's, and it's the second most prevalent condition, neurological condition in the U.S. after Alzheimer's and dementia related disorders. So we've tried to respond to that demand by training other dance instructors around the world to do this work, and they all have different styles, but we're all working sort of under a similar understanding of what our role is. Our role is as a dance facilitator, instructor. We are not trained dance movement therapists. That is a equally valid and parallel track for people, sometimes different issues. So in our classes, we work a lot more on the motor issues and sort of locomotion and as well as expression, things you might have in a typical dance movement therapy session. Not there is such a typical session, but we are not creating a therapeutic relationship with the participants. We're there as teachers, as dance teachers, and that's a different thing. So so the dancerpd.org has a listing of all the classes where this is available. There are 7 locations here in New York where people can join classes in all 5 boroughs. So
just from a rehab perspective, we are close. Well, I have an affiliation with Columbia University Medical Center, and I'll just introduce Jerry Hughes in the back there. And she's a physical therapist who we work very closely with on a lot of these rehab strategies. She's not specifically involved in the dance program, but we do a lot of work together. And I have my card here, so if anyone is interested, I can connect you with Jerry or other therapists and the dance program. So we're happy to do that. One of the first things that we're doing is trying to determine what those factors are, right? So to be very clear and have replicability with the dance. And that's one of the things that I think we're trying to bring to dance is that I think, as Greg had said, it's not just we're doing this kind of dance or that kind of dance, but what are the elements? So that model that we showed really broke that down. Now your question is, how do you know whether it's what the dance instructor said or the dance itself? And that is it's a bigger picture question. So the first thing you have to know is what the elements are, and then you could start to tease them apart. But the only way that you could do that really, truly, is to compare two things head to head. So for example, you could compare a dance with music to without music, right? Or with a certain kind of instruction compared to another kind of instruction. And you have to do those head-to-head comparisons. So we will likely do those in smaller pilot studies to be able to see what's more effective. Is this kind of an instruction more effective than that? And then roll the best package that we can come up with out. And then we'd have to put it head-to-head with another kind of a program. So it's a long process.